We are so happy you guys are here today. Everyone looks amazing in their leis and their Hawaiian shirts. We love it. If you guys would like to stand up, we're going to worship our Lord this morning.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone.
I hear your invitation to let it all go. And I see it now, I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you.
I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, oh.
You saw my condition.
You had a plan from the start.
Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love.
I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again.
Your mercy is calling out, and just as I am, you pull me in, and I know I need you now.
I run to the Father, I fall into grace, I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait, my heart needs surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I'll run to the Father again and again. I run to the Father, I fall into grace, I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart found a surgeon, my soul found a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again.
Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that curse.
his body bound and drenched in tears.
They laid him down
in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God.
Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again.
Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, forevermore, for endless days
we take this moment now and we open our altars, we just want to reflect on how God is working amongst us, not just here at church, but even in areas around our country. There's places like Maui that is just devastated by the fires. But God is still there. God is still there, and He is working. He's ministering to the people. Even amongst the tragedy, God is present. So this morning, we want to remember them and just lift them up in prayer and just continue to intercede for them. Intercessory prayer is an opportunity for us just to lift somebody else up, to carry the burden for them, and just give us a chance to come alongside them and support them. Let them know that we empathize with them, that we hurt with them and what they're going through. We've also had lots of storms here in Michigan and across the Midwest. Lots of people still without power today. We want to continue to keep them in prayer this morning as well. And then our church family. We have people in our church family that are hurting. One in particular, granddaughter, rushed to the hospital this morning with a low heart rate. So we want to make sure that we keep her in prayer as well. God's always working. There's always work to be done. So our job is to come alongside, lift up our brothers and sisters, pray for them, and ask for God's work to be done in their life, ask for His will to be done in their life. So let's do that this morning as we open up the altars. Let's come alongside somebody today in intercessory prayer and just pray for them, lift them up this morning.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest, and without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you in every hour. I need you. You're my one defense and my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
We're still
runs deep. Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. And holiness is Christ in me. And where you are, my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you.
Dear Heavenly Father, oh, like the words we all just cried out to you, Lord, we need you. We can't do it on our own. We need you, Lord. Lord, today we bring to you our sweet Emily and that precious baby. Lord, we know that you are in control. And we know that you can do all things. Lord, we just pray for the doctors and the health of Emily and the baby. Lord, I just thank you for this amazing family of people that we have in this building. People that we know that will go to your feet for us. Lord, I thank you for the hearts of every single person here. Lord, you know their hearts, though. You know their hurts. You know their joys. Lord, I just pray that you can bring peace and comfort to everyone here today. I thank you that this is such a family, that we're able to have fun together and celebrate together and love together and mourn together, Lord. Thank you. As we're going through new seasons, as we're going off to school and schedules are changing and our summer fun is winding down, Lord, I just pray that you are with our families through what can be such a hectic time, Lord, and our children as they go into these buildings. Lord, help them to be a light in the darkness. Help them to be strong and hold on to you, Lord. Help the parents be able to equip them. Lord, I also want to thank you. Thank you for our pastors here, our leaders here that you put in place for us, Lord, as we celebrate them 1 year ago, answering that call of their ordination and choosing to commit to you and us here at Flint First, Lord. I thank you. I raise up Pastors Amy and Pastor Chad. I thank you for what they do and what they're going to continue to do, Lord, and I just pray blessings upon what they have in store for the future. Oh, Lord, I just pray for your spirit to continue to guide them as they build our team, our staff, our church together for just an amazing force for you, not only in this community, but just in
for the kingdom, Lord, everywhere that we can possibly reach. Lord, I just pray that you put a blessing on everything that they have in store for us here at Flint First. Lord, we need you. Help us to remember that. Help us to just stop and listen to your small voice. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, I need you.
Good morning, Flint First. Thank you all for choosing Flint First to worship with us this morning. If you are new or joining us online and we haven't been able to connect with you, go ahead and use that link online, scan that QR code, or stop by the welcome desk on your way out tonight. The QR codes are on the pew in front of you and in your bulletin. We just want to connect with you and join you on your faith journey, wherever it may be. Using those same methods, you can give your tithes and offerings. There's a wood box on the welcome desk in the back. And again, if you want to do it digitally, use that QR code or that link, and we would love that you support our ministry here at Flint First. This Wednesday is our last Wednesday of our summer programming, and we have our community service project scheduled. So we have dinner at 6 starting at here, and then at 6:30 we will be doing our community service project. We are planning on doing the lawn mowing and cleanup that we were planning on doing last month. So if you could plan on bringing your lawn mowers, your lopping shears, gloves, just so we can have more equipment so we can get more work done, that would be great. If you have any questions, please see Pastor Amy or Pastor Chad about that. To continue on, we still are offering our Flint First merchandise as a fundraiser for our youth program. So if you are still interested in purchasing any of those merchandise items, there is a variety of styles and price points. So if you're interested in that, go ahead and use that QR code. Again, you can view the shop that way. Also, if you want to have some help here, you can also see Brianna or Pastor Chad regarding that. Then today, following the service, is our Missions Cafe and Silent Auction. So you'll notice in the back, in the foyer, okay, go ask Daddy then. You'll notice that there is three tables set up of various silent auction items. Make sure that you get your bidding number so then it can be a true silent auction. And if you have any questions regarding that, that is also being ran by Brianna and her team. So, and then join us after service for the cafe part of it. And again, the donations that are put towards that will be helping the individuals that are going on a missions trip at the end of October from Flint First, that they're partnering with Stony Wesleyan Church down in Washington in partnership with Back-to-Back Ministries in Mexico. So if you, again, if you have any questions regarding that, please see Brianna. And at this time, our kids are dismissed to go downstairs with Miss Heather.
Thank you, Hannah. Well, good morning. Good morning. Thank you for that welcome. Thank you. As you can see by the the slide, we're starting a new sermon series. And so we're going to be in this for a couple of weeks. We finished our sermon series on masks. And so now we're going to kind of talk about the Bible doesn't say that. Should be interesting. How many times do we have these Christian, you know, phrases, these cliches that we say, and we think that they're biblical. We think that, in fact, we're trying to, you know, help somebody by saying scripture, and we're going to dig into some of those and see that actually the Bible doesn't say that at all. And so today we're going to unpack, like, I think this is like the king of them all, that God won't give us more than we can handle. Now, I don't know about you, but have you ever tried to do something that was like beginner level? Right? And then you found out that it maybe wasn't so beginner at all. Now, my kids have skied and Nathan snowboard, and I can tell you I never tried because I know I would look like a complete fool trying to do that. I know my knees would not sustain me if I tried to do that. Or, like, have you ever tried some of those beautiful Pinterest ideas, right? Have you ever seen some of those cute little Pinterest crafts or whatever? And maybe you've seen this one and you think, oh, I am going to, like, I'm going to glue crayons and melt them, and it makes this beautiful, like, mosaic, right? Well, that one was mine. Can you see it? I nailed it, didn't I? That is usually what happens, right? Like, so you can follow all the advice. You can follow, you know, the directions to a T, right? And okay, maybe it's just me, but that's what happens, right? So advice can sometimes go that way, right? Like, sometimes advice, although we think we're helping, we're not. And we're going to unpack that today. So yeah, advice can sound great, but that doesn't mean it is. So this series is going to deal with that stark reality that far more often than we really honestly want to admit, that us believers, us followers of Christ, we can actually do more damage by saying things like this. So we think what we are saying is true. And when we think what we are saying is biblical, but it's not found in Scripture anywhere. I don't know, has anybody in this room been told, God won't give you more than you can handle? It's all right. Hang in there. God's not going to give you more than you can handle. And it sounds great, doesn't it? We sometimes want to cling to that because we're like, yes, that kind of has some truth to it, right? Because in Scripture, we see that it says that his burden is light, right? So if we look in Matthew 11, it says, then Jesus said, come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke. Let me teach you, because I'm humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden that I give you is light. So we think that, well, yeah, God's not going to give us more than we can handle. His burden is light, right? Like, yeah, that sounds to be true. It's not. And I wish I didn't have to speak truth, but I'm going to speak truth. And it's not. So where does this misconception come from, that God won't give us more than we can handle. If you'll turn with me to 1 Corinthians 10, we're going to kind of take this verse, because I think this is the verse that so many people kind of get this from, and we're going to unpack it today. So first, we're just going to read it, and then we'll unpack it a little bit. So if you think you are standing strong, be careful not to fall. The temptations in your life are no different from what others experience. And God is faithful. He will not allow the temptation to be more than you can stand. When you're tempted, he will show you a way out of it so that you can endure. And so I think this is where that misconception comes from, that God's not going to give us more than we can handle. But the Apostle Paul is the one who wrote this. This is found in 1 Corinthians. It's his letter to the Corinthians, to the church in Corinth. And remember, when we were studying Ephesians, we talked about how Paul was, the entire time, he was in prison. And Paul was a man who knew great suffering. So I don't think that he's saying this to talk about our sufferings, right? It's specific, because you cannot avoid being tempted, but what does he say? You can always escape it, because God is faithful, and he will not allow the temptation to be more than you can stand. Again, remember Satan, he's a liar. Remember, he is a thief, and he comes to destroy you, right? But also remember Job. Think about Job. God gave the devil permission to only go so far, didn't he? He had a hedge of protection around him. And I think that that's what this is talking about, right? Like, God's going to protect us. He will, and he will always give us an escape. I don't know if any of you have ever seen the movie Oliver and Company, but in the beginning of that movie, you see this tiny little orange kitten, and he's all alone in the streets of New York City. And so you see him trying to navigate, and he's afraid of all the honking, all the noise, and he's kind of running around the streets of New York City. And at one point, he is trying to cross a busy New York street, and he's like ducking, and he can't get through because all the cars, and he's cowering. Well, there's a policeman that sees this poor little kitten, and so he goes out, and when the light turns, and he holds up his stop sign. And then the kitten scurries across the street. Really unaware that he was under the protection and under the authority of the New York police. And so many times, church, we too were under the authority. We're under the protection of God, and we don't even realize it. He's holding up his stop sign, and he says, stop. So God, in his amazingness, right, this verse is referring to temptation, though, right, to temptation, not relieving us of heavy burdens in life. So remember last week as we talked about Paul, think about all the suffering that he went through. And let's look in 2 Corinthians. Again, he's writing to, yeah, go one more, I'm sorry. Thank you, Andrew. 2 Corinthians. One more. Keep going. Here we go. So we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about the troubles we experienced in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure far beyond our ability to endure. So much so that we despaired of life itself. This is the NIV version. Let's take a look at the New Living Translation. The New Living Translation says this: "We think you ought to know, dear brothers and sisters, about the trouble we went through in the province of Asia. We were crushed, overwhelmed, beyond our ability to endure, and we thought we would never live through it." Do you think this is somebody who was experiencing something that was beyond, that God gave them more than that they could withstand? He literally says, we were so overwhelmed, it was beyond our ability to endure, and we thought we would never live through it. Church, we are living in a world where situations are going to come, and God will give us things. He will allow things to happen that will make us feel. And again, feel. Okay, check that emotion, right? So it'll make us feel as if we would never be able to live through it. So this quote about God was not going to give us more than we can handle, it's out of kindness. You know, I think people say that out of kindness, but it's caused a lot of confusion and guilt, quite frankly. So first of all, the theological confusion part, that it suggests that God himself causes all adversity and trouble. So this concept that God will never give you more than you can handle, it means it is God himself who has given you suffering, and that's not true. So this thought pattern can easily leave us confused about who God is. Is he an angry God weighing down on us from heaven and just punishing us? Or is he a loving father that we just sung about, that we can run to with grace and mercy, and who wants nothing more than the best for his children? Do you see the disconnect that this causes? There will be times when we're overwhelmed. And that doesn't necessarily mean that God orders it, right? It's just simply a consequence of living in a broken world that needs redemption. See, God will allow the natural consequences of sin to take place. Remember, sin happened in the beginning, in the garden. And as that effect, the whole earth was cursed, wasn't it? The whole earth was cursed. That is the effect of sin. God doesn't deal lightly with sin, does he? He doesn't mess around. Sin separates us from God. That is why we have to have a Savior. That is why we need Jesus. That's why Jesus came, right? So, but God will allow the natural consequences of sin to take place. Now, he always promises to give us a way out of temptation. Go back and think about Abel and Cain. God was like, be careful. Sin is crouching at your door. He warned. Blaming warning sign. Bah, 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 stop. Sin is crouching, right? Hear those, take heed of those. He's going to warn us. There are guardrails, there are boundaries, there are hedges for a reason. There's a book that talks about the hedges. I don't remember the name of it, Nathan. Do you remember the name of it? But anyways, there's this beautiful book, and there's these hedges, and these two little kids, they wanted to know what was on the other side of these hedges. And so these two kids, they kept trying to get through the hedges. But they couldn't. They were so thick, right? And so the older boy, he's like, tries to push his smaller sister through the hedges, but they were just so intertwined and woven, and she couldn't get through there. And then she actually ended up getting like a thorn stuck in her eye. And then she became blind because of it. And then later, you find out in the story that the person that lived in that house before them had planted these hedges there because right on the other side of those hedges was this terrible steep cliff. And he had lost a son who had fallen off the cliff. And so he did not want anybody else to have to go through that. So he planted these very tight, twisted hedges. And so many times, our curiosity, our nature, we want to know what's on the other side. And God says, I have hedges for your protection. Boundaries, guardrails on the expressway. They're for our protection, right? So that a car doesn't go off the expressway at 70 miles an hour into oncoming traffic, right? If it were to get into an accident, there are guardrails for a reason. There are hedges. There are boundaries. There are these things for a reason. These are the things that God has put in place to protect us. Just like we have a toddler who always wants to touch the stove, right? They're very curious. They want to see the stove, right? And now we tell them time and time again, little Johnny, don't touch the stove. It's hot. You're going to burn yourself, right? And then one day, they touch the stove. They burn themselves. They get a terrible blister. It hurts, doesn't it? Now, did God ordain that little boy to touch the stove? No. His curiosity, right, drove him to touch the stove. But God did allow the pain from the burn, didn't he? He allows the natural consequences of sin for us to hopefully learn from it, right? So that we understand that. So now little Johnny, when we tell him, don't touch the stove, he's like, oh, yeah, I burnt myself. It hurt. I'm not going to do that again, right? So there are natural consequences for sin that God does allow. And that doesn't mean that he is the one that is punishing us for that. No, he's just hoping that we learn from it. It's just a normal, natural consequence, right? And again, part of it is because we live in a broken, cursed world because of sin. Now, the second part, think about Jonah, actually, before we go on to the second part. This is important. Think about Jonah. His disobedience allowed him to sit in the belly of a whale, right? God will allow us to sit in the belly of a whale. He will. When the only thing we can do is to cry out to him and ask for his help, right? So now Jonah experienced that because of his direct disobedience to God. And sometimes we directly disobey God, and then we wonder why we have natural consequences from that, right? God allowed Jonah to sit in that pit of that fish, whale, whatever you want to call it, right? God allowed that. But now we kind of talked about Job, too. And then you're like, okay, but Pastor Amy, like when you say Job, he wasn't disobedient. In fact, Scripture says he was a righteous man. And yet he experienced all of that. And it's because here on this earth, you will have many trials and sorrows. We don't like to hear that, do we? It's actually a promise, and it's found in John 16:33, if you'll go to that slide, Andrea. Here on earth, you're going to have many trials and sorrows. And so when we think about the promises of God, we want to think about the happy, good promises of God. His promises to never leave us or forsake us. His promise for a hope and a future. His promise for all the wonderful blessings that he's going to give us, right? We don't want to think about his promise that there will be many trials and sorrows. But we have to understand the second part to that. But take heart, because I have overcome the world. So not only does this fault of God's not going to give you more than you can handle cause this theological confusion, it also leads to guilt. See, because if God can never give me more than I can handle, what's wrong with me that I can't handle this? In church, that's where I was when my mom died. I thought, I can't handle this. And I didn't handle it well the first few months after my mom died. Terrible. And I, like, just to say that, like, I don't think people truly understand until you've walked through grief and walked through that. Now you can understand that for other people. But so this misconception that God's not going to give you more than you can handle, it makes people feel like, well, then what's so wrong with me? I'm so broken, right? I'm a failure. And that's simply not true. There is going to be a lot of pressures in this life. Chad talked about it before we entered into the prayer time, right? Like, take out your bulletin. We have so many prayer requests, right? Like, and just this church alone, front and back, right? There are going to be trials in this life. And there's going to be just seriously hard tragedies. And sometimes it's in that moment when someone who means well, and they do, I don't think they're trying to make you feel guilty, right? But again, it's out of kindness. It's trying to say, oh, it's okay. You can do it. God's not going to give you more than you can handle. But again, let's unpack that, because it's simply not true. Because suffering is universal. It's simply universal. We're going to all experience hardship and suffering. Doesn't matter how young, how old. Everyone experiences it. And sometimes we learn powerful lessons from it, right? Like I talked about with the burned finger. Sometimes we learn, you know, good lessons from it. And sometimes it's self-inflicted, like Jonah, right? And sometimes our lives are just touched by random act of violence or whatever, right? Again, just consequences of living in a broken world. But that doesn't mean that God caused it. God doesn't orchestrate it. Right, and so many times when you hear about these huge disasters, or there's like a tragic car accident, or you know whatever, people are like, "Oh, how can a loving God allow that to happen?" And that is our heart's cry, isn't it? Like, God, how could you allow that to happen? You love your people, you know. Like, why would you allow that, God? All those lives lost, all that devastation. Chad talked about Maui, like all that island burned, right? All the fires that we were dealing with from Canada, like the smoke was causing problems with us, right? Like all of those things that go on in the world, it's not that God, again, from heaven is like, my people are gonna pay. That's what they get. I mean, it's what we deserve, quite frankly. It's what we deserve. But that's not how he is. He is a loving father that we can run to in our times of just utter, like, I can't do it. I can't endure this. So, again, like, when we look at the verse in 1 Corinthians, Paul says that troubles are universal. The temptations in your life are no different from what others experience. We all experience the same temptations. But Satan wants you to think you are the only one going through what you're going through, right? He wants you to hide. He wants you to live in isolation. He wants you to stay away because he wants you to feel like you are all alone. And it's not the truth. They are no different from what others experience. Again, we're not exempt from suffering. And it's not that once I become a Christian, now that I'm a follower of Christ, now I'm suddenly immune to suffering. Far from it. Christ followers are just as affected by natural disasters, just as vulnerable to mental illness, and just as likely to have family problems. Again, look at our prayer sheet. It's full of it, right? And Chad and I, we love to pray over these, by the way. We absolutely do. It's a great privilege that we have to be able to bear these burdens with our people. But listen, just because we're Christians doesn't mean we're not going to experience hardship, right? And I think it's encouraging because even Paul reached his tipping point, right? In 2 Corinthians, we read that it was beyond our ability to endure. Again, Paul went through suffering too, and he felt like it was more than he can endure. Again, our sufferings, our trials, they're no different. We all experience these things. But we see in the next part of the passage a distinct turning to God. And Paul says, as a result, we stopped relying on ourselves. We stopped relying on ourselves and learned to rely only on God. Again, who raises the dead, right? We talked about that with the mask series with Ephesians. We stopped relying on ourselves. We cannot endure suffering. We really can't. But God is faithful. The next point, God is faithful. Oh, thank God. So many times yesterday at the ladies' retreat, Marcy and I looked at each other because one of the passages was, but God. And so Marcy, she looked over at me and she was like, but God. I was like, but God. Or, and God is faithful. Right? The suffering's going to come. The trials are going to come. I wish I could tell you that they're not. But I'm sorry that this is a kind of a downer of a sermon. But it's just simply not true. One of his promises is we're going to have trials and sufferings. I'm sorry. But God gave us the body of Christ, and he is faithful. Right? He is faithful. So, and when we think about this lie that God's not going to give us more than we can handle, it's actually self-centered. It's actually full of pride because it's focusing on me. It tells me that I can bear whatever comes my way if I just pull myself up by my bootstraps, then everything will be okay. And God's never going to pour out trials, suffering at a faster rate than I can handle, right? But this conventional wisdom points people in to me, towards my ability, right? And we need to point to God, right? So God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble. So we will not fear when earthquakes come and mountains crumble into the sea. Oh, let the oceans roar and foam. Let the mountains tremble as the waters surge. He gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. Yes, suffering isn't universal. And at times, it may be more than we can handle. But please hear me when I say this. Sometimes life gives us more than we can handle, but it never, ever, ever gives us more than he can handle. Amen is right. Amen. Yes, amen. And the third point is you're not alone, right? God's design for life is based in community, right? First with him and us, right? That's a community. I mean, God exists in a community in three persons. God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit, right? So God's design is for community. He wants us to be in community. And so we're not alone. And community, it allows us to hear truth, right? Again, sometimes you're going to hear the, well, God's not going to give you more than you can handle. Hang in there. You know, you got this. But it's also going to give us truth like, listen, I know this stinks, but we're here for you, and we're going to pray for you, and we're going to pray you through this, right? We're going to help you get through this. We're going to minister to you. We're going to bring you meals if we have to. We're going to do whatever it's going to take, right? We're going to walk through this with you. And that's what the body of believers does. And it's so beautiful when the body of believers does that, right? And it also, it gives us our identity, right? Again, God wants, or the Satan wants us all alone, cut off from all of us believers, right? He wants us feeling so empty, so alone, so trapped, so whatever, that we don't even know what is up and down, right? That's what Satan wants. He thinks it's a fun game. He's going to keep us locked in that cage and torment us in the cage. But it's when we come and we are part of a community, part of a beautiful body such as this, right, that we can get the edification, we can get the encouragement, we can get the, you got this, we're here for you. We all face temptations, trials, and hard times. And being a Christ follower, it doesn't protect us from that. But when we are tempted, we need to remember that God has provided us a way out. Again, Satan wants us to believe we're isolated in weakness. But the reality is, everything that we face in life, someone around you knows what you're going through. Someone can walk alongside you, right? If you're willing to remove your mask, right? If you're willing to admit that you're struggling. Remember, God does say in his promises that he will never leave us or forsake us. So bad things, they may happen, and they happen to us, but they don't have to define us, right? So we have to remember there are two things that we need in this life. I cannot make it in this life without God, and I cannot make it in this life without others. It is so simple. There's going to be times in this life when it's really more than we can handle. But when you're hurt and the pain is too much to bear alone, remember, and this is truth, you are not alone. Again, we talked about this verse in the beginning. Then Jesus said, come to me, all of you, if you're weary and you're carrying burdens, again, let me give you rest. Take my yoke, right? You know what that is like? Like two oxen, they would usually yoke two oxen together. And especially when they were training oxen, so it'd usually be an older oxen with a younger oxen. And the older oxen would carry most of the weight, and the little younger ox would just kind of walk beside him, you know, as they were plowing along. So the older, stronger ox who knew the route would go up and down, and the younger one, he was just kind of following along, really, just kind of walking and going along as he was learning it. And that's what Jesus is saying. I'm going to basically carry the burden for you. You just have to walk along. Let me just walk along. There's going to be suffering. And church, I wish that weren't the case. I really do. But it's not the truth. There's going to be suffering. But let me teach you. Let me teach you. Again, he's going to teach us. Because his yoke is light. We can find rest in our souls as he's bearing that weight and we're just walking along. Let us rest in that. It's in those times that he's basically carrying us. When my mom died, I had shared this yesterday at the ladies' retreat. I could not hear God's voice anymore. I couldn't read my Bible anymore. I literally, church, I was struggling for several months. I was struggling. And I was just numb. Like, I didn't really feel a lot of emotions. I just was plain numb. And I couldn't. And I remember talking to Chad, and I'm like, I don't think I'm depressed because I'm not even sad. Like, I don't even know what I feel, quite honestly, I don't know what to feel. I'm just numb. I said, but I cannot hear God's voice. When I read my devotionals, when I read my Bible, I would read the same verse 6 or 7 times, and I'm like, what did I just read? I'm struggling, right? And Chad had said, he's carrying you. He's carrying you. Rest. Rest in that and trust that he's carrying you. And I just was like, okay, I'll go through the motions, right? I just was kind of going through the motions and resting that he was carrying me. And church, he's going to carry you through those trials too, because he did carry me. And I can look back now and I can see that he was carrying me. Even though I couldn't really feel like I was being carried, I didn't feel his arms like I feel his arms some days, right? I couldn't feel that because, I was numb. But I know without a shadow of a doubt, I know that I know that I know that I know that I know he was carrying me. And it's because of people like you in this congregation who were praying for me. You were praying me through that. It was a dark tunnel. And I was in the middle of the tunnel, and I knew that there was light ahead, right? But right now, at that time, I was in the dark. And I had to keep looking forward to the light, because the light was coming. But right now, it's dark. Think about that when you're going through, like, have you ever traveled down to Virginia or something like that and gone through big, long tunnels? When we were in Colorado, we went through the Vail Pass, and there's this long tunnel that's very dark, and you lose all, like, your satellite, your phone doesn't have any service, right? Like, have you ever gone through one of those big, long tunnels like that, and it's dark, right? Like, you're like, woo, good thing the lights are working, it's dark in here. You don't have cell phone service, right? So if you break down right now, you're like, woo, Lord, just get me through this tunnel. That's what it's like, right? Like, and he does get us through it, doesn't he? He does. See, and Paul reminds the church that their temptations are common. They're common to all of us. So it's a reminder that we can face tomorrow and we can overcome. Their scripture is filled with stories of those. And they're more than just bedtime stories, right? It's factual history lessons of situation after situation of people unable to handle what God was allowing them to experience. It's in his mercy that he gave them his strength. Think about Noah, who built an ark for a catastrophic flood in the desert, though they had never seen rain. How crazy he must have been, right? Like, the people really must have thought he was absolutely crazy, and yet he did it. He didn't know what he was doing, but God showed him, right? Think about Abraham as he heard God's call to leave everything he had known and to go into the wilderness all alone with just his wife. Think about Joshua as he took the command of the children of Israel as they were, you know, wandering through the desert for 40 years. I think that was more than he could endure. Think about Mary, a virgin, never had any sexual relation before, and yet she's birthing a child. Think about that. I'm sure that that was more than she could endure. Think about a Nazarene carpenter who called fishermen, who called tax collectors to leave everything behind and to follow him. Think about the lame that Jesus commanded to walk, though they had never walked before and didn't understand how to put one foot in front of the other. Think about the blind who were now able to see and never understand what a tree looked like, what the sky looked like, what the grass looked like, but they knew what it felt like. And now as they are able to see, think about those things. Scriptures are filled. And that's just barely scratching the surface. of how God's servants were ill-equipped to carry the load that they had given them. So don't let Satan tell you differently with his lies and his manipulations, because, church, remember, we are free forever and ever, and we are forgiven in God's love. I have a dear, dear friend, and I've shared this story a couple of times. Again, when my mom died and I said I couldn't hear God's voice, one of my dearest friends, she had walked through heaven a stillborn, and her story is in this collection of stories in this book. It's called The Hope in the Morning, and her story is captured there. Our kids are our good friends. Our daughters were in AHG together. She's also a nurse, so she's my colleague. Not only is she my friend, but she's a colleague. She's a dear friend. And so her story of her losing their baby and having to have delivered a stillborn, it's shared in this book. And I encourage you, if anybody is going through some things, and especially grief, I really encourage you to maybe get this book, or let me lend it to you. There's just a lot of hope in this book. But one of the things that she writes, and I just thought this was so perfect, so I had to share it. But she said, from the things that the Christian community did that were really encouraging, she talks about all of those things. And then she said the things that were not encouraging is this. The lie that God won't give you more than you can handle. This is unbiblical and just a flat-out lie. And I'm probably guilty of using it or even agreeing with it at sometimes. However, he does give us more than we can handle, and on a regular basis, so that we can rely on him and his strength, so that he can be our strength and our power. And so there's a beautiful picture of my friend and her dear baby that she had to deliver. And just a shout out for this book, Hope in the Morning, and to my friend Carrie, my dear sister, my dear friend Carrie, and the struggle that she went through. Church, I wish I could give you a better message other than, but God. Suffering is going to come. That's going to be part of this life. We live in a broken, sin-cursed world. But God. God is going to give us the strength to endure. He's going to give us his strength. If we rely on him and stop trying to do it by our own might. And I know I'm guilty of that too. I try to do it in my own might, think I can handle it all. Another thing I said in the ladies' retreat yesterday is that I am a recovering control freak. Hi, my name is Amy, and I'm a recovering control freak. We do it, don't we? Like, I don't think I'm the only one. Like I said, I'll admit it. I will admit it. Chad is probably sitting over here like, finally. And she did it in public, so I can replay it when she said she's not a control freak. He's going to mark this on the phone. You better believe it. And they're cracking up because they know it's true. They're going to, but you said. So I'm going to eat these words in the future. I'm sure of it, but that's okay. But yet, like, why do we want to be in control? Do we really want all that responsibility, all that weight, all of that? Like, no. Let him handle it, who is far more capable to handle it than we are, right? And just trust that he is going to carry the weight. And we just have to walk alongside. And sometimes it's not going to be easy. But we have a body of Christ here, and we have a body of believers who are going to encourage each other, love each other, when we're having off days, when we're having difficult days, when we're exhausted and at our ends, and we can have brothers and sisters who come alongside of us and pray for us and encourage us. And that is what is so beautiful about the church, about the body of Christ. So it's a lie, right? God's not going to give you more than you can handle. We've unpacked that. It's a lie. So let the truth of God's word, not your circumstances. Circumstances are going to come. So let the truth of God's word define your decisions today. Pray with me. Dear Lord, we thank you for your word and for meeting with us this week. What an encouragement it is to know that whatever life throws our way, we don't have to face it alone. May we let go of the things that are not ours to take into the promise of what is waiting for us tomorrow. And Lord, we're just going to lay those at your feet. Thank you for the reminder to refocus our lives on you and grow where we need to grow so that we don't keep repeating the same mistakes again and again. Lord, we're going to pick up the redemption that you give, the new life that you offer, and we're going to cling to your promises. And we're going to take your new mercies that you give every day. And we're going to look ahead to the future with hope and a restored faith. And we're going to carry that forward for those around us who feel hopeless and whose faith may be shaky. Because, Lord, there's no condemnation in you. Let us just encourage each other, Lord. Thank you for your presence. For your transformation through your word. We pray these things in the name of the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, and worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, and worthy is the King who conquered the grave. That worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that. that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen and amen and amen. Jesus, we sing for all that you've done for us. Don't forget, today, following the service, we have the Mission Cafe, and we have the silent auction going on. So help raise some money to support those who are going to back-to-back in Mexico. And so may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. You're dismissed, church.